Article 1, Section 2, the House. The House of Representatives shall be composed of members chosen every second year by the people of the several states. So, representatives serve two-year terms, and they're all elected at the same time. In theory, each representative could be replaced, and the House of Representatives could be completely new every 2 years. That is, of course, only in theory. And the electors in each state shall have the qualifications requisite for electors of the most numerous branch of the state legislature. Basically, all we need to know from that clause is that voter qualifications are determined at the state level, and that there are no expressed voting rights at the national level. There are protections about why you can't be disenfranchised from voting through several amendments that we will look at later. Requisite means required. No person shall be a representative who shall not have attained to the age of 25 years and been 7 years a U.S. citizen, and who shall not, when elected, be an inhabitant of that state in which he shall be chosen. Those are the three constitutional qualifications of representatives of the House. Notice the young age of 25. No representative has been elected at such a young age, but it is at least possible, which is again an example of the less strict nature, the hot tea nature of the House of Representatives. Also, I'd like to point out the constitutional use of the double negative. No person who shall not have attained 25 years. Moving on. Representatives and direct taxes shall be apportioned among the several states which may be included within this union, according to their respective numbers, which shall be determined by adding to the whole number of free persons, including those bound to service for a term of years, and excluding Indians not taxed, 3/5 of all other persons. In this podcast, we'll be listening to the entire Constitution, even these parts that were changed by amendments later on. This portion was changed by the 14th Amendment, Section 2, in 1866. The representative numbers and direct taxes still apportioned among the several states, but no longer counted 3/5 of a person, the slaves. This is, of course, the 3/5 compromise. And we will also note how slavery is not expressly mentioned in the Constitution, remaining our dirty little secret. According to their respective numbers, representatives in the House are determined by the population of the states. Also, direct taxes were determined according to their respective numbers and the population of the states. This lacked a little bit of foresight on their part. You could have a large state of really poor people and a small state of really wealthy people, but the wealth was not taken into account, at least in the Constitution. Going on, the actual enumeration shall be made within 3 years after the first meeting of Congress of the United States, and within every subsequent term of 10 years. This enumeration, of course, is the census. It has been continued on since the first one in 1790, in such manner as they shall by law direct. The number of representatives shall not exceed 1 for every 30,000. If we stuck to this constitutional ratio, we would have 10,000, almost 11,000 members in the House of Representatives. But in 1929, they limited the number to 435 members, which we still have today, making it a much more reasonable number. Otherwise, we're talking about a small, like minor league stadium full of people trying to decide on things. Goes on, but each state shall have at least one representative. So even if your population is less than 30,000, you would still get one representative. They give a provision for what representation to give to each state until such enumeration shall be made. The state of New Hampshire shall be entitled to choose 3, Massachusetts 8, Rhode Island and Providence plantations 1, Connecticut 5, New York 6, New Jersey 4, Pennsylvania 8, Delaware 1, Maryland 6, Virginia 10, North Carolina 5, South Carolina 5, and Georgia 3. So those are the temporary numbers. States were not originally districted, is my understanding. That came into effect later, how we have the districts in the states with the equal population in each district. So as the math works out now with the population estimate in 2017 of 325 million plus people, the breakdown by 435 leads to about 475,000 people per district that each representative represents. So the districting leads to the idea of gerrymandering, which we won't get into too deeply here, but it is important to understand the idea that gerrymandering is redrawing district lines for political advantage. Either party can take care of this. It could be determined by race. There are some interesting plans out to eliminate or at least reduce the effect of gerrymandering so that our districts are fair and our representation is proportional and equal to the people who are living within certain regions, and that no political advantage is given to one party or another, or one race or another, or whatever, one religion or another. There's lots of reasons why you could break those up that would be unfair. When vacancies happen in the representation from any state, the executive authority thereof shall issue writs of election to fill such vacancies. An important note that if there is a death or a resignation, that the governor of the state is the one that appoints the replacement and writes a special election to fill the vacancy. The House of Representatives shall choose their speaker and other officers and shall have the sole power of impeachment. They choose their Speaker of the House. They conduct the day-to-day business of the House. And the sole power of impeachment. Impeachment is the power to charge officials in the executive and judicial branches with wrongdoing and bring them to trial. So impeachment is the official government term for indictment, which happens in normal criminal cases. So the House draws up the charges, and then a majority vote approves the charges, and then it's on to the Senate. We'll talk more about that when we get to the Senate.